Having been in public life for many decades, I have participated in many, many functions, very variegated. But I must say that this is a function of a unique kind. Never before have I had the privilege of inaugurating a Hindu spiritual and service fair as this one. And for all, for this unique opportunity, I owe a debt of immense gratitude to my old friend and colleague, Sri Guru Murthy. Sometimes I wonder, I think, how come that in India there are functions in the name of many communities, many castes, but it's very rare that anyone organizes a function in the name of Hindus. Would anything of this kind happen in, say, any Western country dominated by the Christian community? But in India it does happen. And the good part of it is that it is a Hindu function which doesn't emphasize Hinduism as much as it does service, seva. And in a way tries to emphasize that there can be no Hinduism without seva. I have often in my mention of Swami Vivekananda referred to the fact that in the year 1897, he returned from a trip to the West and he landed in Chennai. At that time it wasn't known as Chennai, it was known as Madras. And in an auditorium, I do not know where, but it was also the month of February. When he came to India, returned to India after a trip to the West in 1897, and people who had come to listen to him in that auditorium, they had come mainly to hear a powerful sermon on his concept of Vedanta. And he did speak about religion, he did speak about Hindu spiritualism, but the thrust of his speech that day was, all of you here worship some or the other god or goddess. My appeal to you is that for the coming 50 years, let the goddess that you worship remain asleep. Go to sleep. And let only one goddess remain alive, awake and alive, and that is Mother India, Bharat Mata. One of the objectives of this particular fair, as told to me and explained here also by Swamiji, is that Hinduism or Hindu spiritualism does not mean any unconcern for social welfare. And so when in the year 1897 such a great spiritual leader like Swami Vivekananda, whose greatness was acknowledged not merely by our own country, but by the whole world. It's very rare that just a few words of an opening speech can create such a deep impact as Swami Vivekananda's address to the Chicago Parliament of Religions. The mere phrase, the appellation, not using the usual phrase of ladies and gentlemen, Swami Vivekananda said, sisters and brothers of America, and then went on to deliver his speech. Though that single phrase, sisters and brothers of America, evoked such a response from the audience that there were deafening cheers for a long, long time. Of course, his speech that day was an exposition of what Hinduism is. And he said, sectarianism, bigotry, and its horrible descendant, fanaticism, have long possessed this beautiful earth. They have filled the earth with violence, drenched it often and often with human blood, destroyed civilizations, and sent whole nations to despair. Had it not been for these horrible demons, human society would be far more advanced than it is now. Demons means fanaticism. Fanaticism is something that if it exists in a society, it cannot allow the biggest political system in the world today, acknowledged by everyone, democracy, to survive. I remember around the year 1990, a television team coming from Canada, coming to interview me in my party office in New Delhi. And the question posed to me was, they said that from among the developing countries of the world, it seems that only India has been able to evolve as a successful democracy. Can you explain this to us? He said, you've been in public life since 1951, when Dr. Shyama Prasad Mukherjee formed the Bharatiya Jana Sangh. And since then, you have had so many kinds of responsibilities. And today our question to you is, what is the root of India's success so far as democracy is concerned? I said that India has never been fanatic. India has never been intolerant to a different point of view. So much so that even though the country by and large has been God-fearing, intensely believes in God, nevertheless, an agnostic, an atheist like Charvak, who said, Yavat jivam sukham jivet rinam kritva ghritam pibet bhasmi bhutasya dehasya punaragamanam kuta. And when he talked about rinam kritva ghritam pibet, take loans and eat ghee, he was not talking about any credit cards. He was simply advocating the philosophy of eat, drink and be merry. After all, there is no such thing, those who tell you that there'll be rebirth again, don't care for them. Punaragamanam kuta. And such a person who is a proclaimed atheist, non-believer, he is not merely tolerated but respected as Rishi Charvak. He is called Rishi. No country in the world would you have someone believing in a different, totally different from the prevalent notion. a believer, a non-believer or like this, this being described as a rishi. It is only in India where you have such an approach to a totally diametrically different point of view. And I said to the Canadian team which was interviewing me, I said, it is in the field of religion that you see the greatest amount of intolerance. And when you have this kind of approach, even in the field of religion, so far as sociology is concerned or politics is concerned or other branches of life are concerned, there can be no fanaticism and there can be no intolerance to a diametrically different point of view. And not merely tolerance for a different point of view, but actual respect for a different point of view. It is only in India that you see this kind of approach. And therefore it is that I hold that in India, democracy has been a wonderful success, even though when we adopted our constitution in 1950, I remember the kind of comments Churchill made or Western scholars made. How can you have democracy in a country where people cannot read and write, where people cannot sign their own names and they have to put a thumb impression in order to sign any document? And therefore it was that everyone believed. I remember those days very well. Those days the country used to talk not so much about who after Nehru, but what after Nehru. It was believed in the West that it is only because of Nehru that India is a democracy today. And the moment Nehruji is not there, one doesn't know what will happen to India. India's democracy will not survive. I have seen this country surviving not only Nehru's passing away, but even a phase like the emergency in 1977. It has survived, and as a vigorous democracy, still cherishing all those values. And this is Swami Vivekananda's 150th anniversary. I may share something with you, which I have not shared as yet with anyone. Only this week, I had occasion to visit the Rashtrapati Bhavan to have a longish discussion with the new Rashtrapati, Pranab Mukherjee. And Pranab ji and I have been together in Parliament for a long time. I remember coming to Parliament in 1970, April, and he had come a few months before that. So since that time, we two have been working together in Parliament, starting with the Rajya Sabha, but coming to the Lok Sabha. And for all these years, since then, we have perhaps been the senior most members of Parliament. Only a few months back, when he was elevated to the Rashtrapati Bhavan, I became the senior most in Parliament. That's all. So he referred to that. I said, you have invited me today, but I would like to plead with you. I would say that if Swami Vivekananda became renowned the world over, and even in India, his impact was felt very greatly, it was because of that Chicago Conference of Parliaments, Chicago Parliament of Religions. I feel that in this 150th anniversary of Swami Vivekananda, it would be appropriate if you approach the American government and ask them to have a very special function in Chicago, where you and Mr. Obama jointly address the gathering on the teachings of Swami Vivekananda, what he gave to the world. And I am happy to say that he said he would pursue this idea. My own, of course, I have often said that I have been reading Swamiji's views and Swamiji's lectures, and this particular speech of his at Chennai, at Madras, in which he asked all the entire audience to let all gods rest and let one goddess remain awake and alive, and that is Mother India, Bharat Mata. I said this was the greatest spiritual leader of that time, showing his concern for the people, not merely about spirituality, but about the people, how for the next 50 years. And it's significant, it's remarkable that he said this in the year 1897. Used the phrase 50 years. And exactly 50 years after 1897 came 1947. What vision, what an approach. And here, this kind of person, I have with me what he spoke about his own religion, telling the Parliament of Religions, and said, "I am proud to belong to a religion which has taught the world both tolerance and universal acceptance. We believe not only in universal toleration, but we accept all religions as true. I am proud to belong to a nation which has sheltered the persecuted and the refugees of all religions and all nations of the world. I am proud to tell you that we have gathered in our bosom the purest remnant of the Israelites who came to southern India and took refuge with us in the very year in which their holy temple was shattered to pieces by Roman tyranny. I am proud to belong to the religion which has sheltered and is still fostering the remnant of the great Zoroastrian nation, the Parsis. I will quote to you, brethren, a few lines from a hymn which I remember to have repeated from my earliest boyhood, which is every day repeated by millions of human beings." And he quoted, "As the different streams having their sources in different paths, which men take through different tendencies, various though they appear, crooked or straight, all lead to thee. The present convention, which is one of the most august assemblies ever held, is in itself a vindication, a declaration to the world of the wonderful doctrine preached in the Gita. Whoever comes to me, through whatsoever form, I reach him. All men are struggling through paths which in the end lead to me." Now, this kind of philosophy propounded by Hinduism and enunciated by Swami Vivekananda to that Parliament of Religions only emphasized that we are singularly fortunate in belonging to this country and to this religion. It makes every one of us feel proud, and I have had greatest association with Parsis, the Zoroastrians he referred to. And I can also mention to you that only a few days back, a girl in a family I have known since my school days in Karachi was married to someone from Turkey. I went to that marriage ceremony, to that wedding, and I was surprised to find that there were a large number of as many as 20-25 Turkish people there. I inquired from the girl, I said, "Who are they?" to what religion do they belong? Because they were from Turkey. I was curious to know. And they said, she told me that they are Baha'is, all of them. I said, how come that this kind of marriage has taken place? She said, I was a student, MBA student in London. This boy also was a MBA student in London. And there we met. And my parents said, we have no objection. There's Baha'is are in a way like Parsis. And it's remarkable that in India, you can have Baha'is and Zoroastrians, all of them coming in that manner and becoming part of the. And they, of course, were very keen that we have come to Delhi for the first time, all of us, 30 of us. And we have heard about the Lotus Temple, the Baha'i Lotus Temple in New Delhi. So we would be keen to visit that temple. I said, you visit that Baha'i temple, but you must also visit Akshardham in New Delhi, which is the biggest temple in the whole country. And all of them went the next day to these two temples. I am referring to this because it is this kind of approach of Hinduism and the interpretation of Hindu philosophy that has earned us great respect in the world. And when that becomes associated with seva, with what we in Hinduism called danam, then the greatness of our religion becomes so evident to all that I feel really proud. I am told that in this very city, Chennai, there is a Vivekananda Illam or Vivekananda House, earlier known as Ice House or Castle Cayman. It is the place where Swamiji stayed for 9 days, incidentally, during this very month between February 6th and 14th, when he visited Chennai in 1897. The building now houses a permanent exhibition on Indian culture and Swamiji's life. I feel very happy to be here and to formally inaugurate this great exhibition that is having its fifth year. Started in 2009 and now this is the year 2013. And this is the fifth Hindu spiritual and service fair. With these words, I formally declare this exhibition open.
Now time for felicitation. Sri Sardarmal Chodia, Secretary, Jain College, will honor Sri L.K. Advani Ji.
Being the grandson of the renowned late Sri Ramnath Goenka, सर्वे भद्राणि पश्यन्तु मा कश्चित् दुःखभागः।